ओके सो टुडेज टॉपिक इज कैस्केड सिस्टम। सी फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड लाइक टू टेल यू दैट ए कैस्केड सिस्टम इज यूज्ड व्हेन वी हैव टू गो फॉर लो टेम्परेचर्स। सो लो टेम्परेचर से अप टू -90 डिग्री सेल्सियस, इफ आई हैव टू गो देन आई विल गो फॉर ए कैस्केड सिस्टम। आई विल नॉट यूज मल्टी स्टेजिंग। ओके सो मल्टी स्टेजिंग इज आउट ऑफ क्वेश्चन व्हेन वी हैव टू गो टू क्वाइट लो टेम्परेचर्स। नाउ देयर आर सर्टेनली सम एप्लीकेशंस फॉर कैस्केड सिस्टम। दीज एप्लीकेशंस आर, नंबर वन इज ब्लड स्टोरेज विच कॉरस्पॉन्ड्स टू -88 डिग्री सेल्सियस, एंड मटीरियल टेस्टिंग इज अनदर एप्लीकेशन। सो इन कैस्केड सिस्टम वी आर यूजिंग टू और मोर सिंपल सैचुरेटेड वेपर कंप्रेशन साइकिल्स and clubbing them actually. So here what you can see is I have shown two circuits of simple vapor compression cycle. The first one is the high temperature circuit and the second one is the low temperature circuit. The low temperature circuit is working between temperature limits of -50 degrees Celsius and 2 degrees Celsius, whereas the high temperature circuit is working between 3 degrees Celsius and 50 degrees Celsius. Now let us consider the low temperature circuit. In the low temperature circuit, the products to be cooled or space to be cooled is at -50 degrees Celsius. So the heat is entering at -50 degrees Celsius. And for an instance, we can consider that the heat is being rejected at 2 degrees Celsius to the surroundings. So this is QC1. Okay, so this heat is being rejected. Similarly, the other system is working and its evaporator, this is the evaporator of high temperature circuit. So here it is taking heat at -3 degrees Celsius and it is rejecting heat at 50 degrees Celsius. So actually, if the heat QC1 is rejected to the evaporator of high temperature circuit, then by combining these two circuits, we can achieve a temperature which is equal to -50 degrees Celsius in the evaporator. So let us see the next slide. So here what I have done is I have combined both the systems, and in the evaporator the heat which is entering is QE1. In the low temperature circuit, the condenser is transferring heat QC1 and it is entering into the high temperature circuit as QE2, whereas the heat rejected from the condenser is QC2. So it means effectively I can say that the value of QC1 should be equal to QE2. So if these two values are equal, then the condenser for the lower circuit is working as the evaporator for the high temperature circuit. So this component, as you can see, this is the intermediate component and this is actually known as cascade condenser, or its another name is evaporator condenser. Evaporator condenser. So I hope this much is clear to you. Here we are supplying WC1 work in the low temperature circuit compressor, and here we are supplying WC2 in high temperature circuit. Now this is the diagram. On the right hand side you can see the pH diagram. In the pH diagram it shows the low temperature circuit from 1, 2, 3, and 4. It is just, you can see, it is the simple saturated vapor compression cycle only. Now let us see how the high temperature circuit is connected to it. Now you can see it here. In high temperature circuit is shown by the green lines, and the state points are from 5, 6, 7 and 8. There is one more interesting point about it is that the temperature TC1 is higher than the temperature TE2. So TC1 is greater than TE2. So it means if the temperature TC1 is, if I am considering as 2 degrees Celsius and TE2 is minus 3 degrees Celsius, so there is a difference of 5 degrees Celsius between them. And it is this temperature difference which is responsible for the heat transfer from the low temperature circuit to the high temperature circuit actually. And this temperature difference of 5 degrees Celsius on the pH diagram is shown by this A. Now what does this A stand for? This A is actually known as approach. Approach means this is the temperature difference between low temperature circuit and high temperature circuit, and it is given by TC1 minus TE2. And if you will see, TC1 temperature as I have considered here is 2 degrees Celsius minus TE2 is minus 3 degrees Celsius, and it comes out to be 5 degrees Celsius. So this approach is necessary for the heat transfer from the low temperature circuit to the high temperature circuit. Other points, if you will see, they are similar to as in case of a single stage vapor compression cycle. Okay. Now let us discuss a few more things about the cascade system. Why we are going for a cascade system and what are the reasons for that. The use of a single refrigerant in a simple vapor compression cycle for the production of low temperature is limited by the following reasons. That is, we cannot use a single stage vapor compression cycle due to the following reasons. And what are these reasons? Number one is the solidification temperature of the refrigerant. Now suppose we have to go to minus 90 degrees Celsius. If we want to go to minus 90, and if we are using a refrigerant for which the freezing temperature is say minus 80 degrees Celsius, so in a single stage we cannot go below, let us say, minus 60 or minus 70 degrees Celsius, because in that particular case, if the freezing point is minus 80 and if you are going below minus 80, the refrigerant will freeze in the circuit. So that means in a single stage system, the freezing point is important because the refrigerant will solidify at its freezing point. Next is the extremely low pressures in the evaporator and large suction volume if a high boiling refrigerant is selected. Now, what is the meaning of the high boiling refrigerant? Suppose if I am choosing a high boiling refrigerant, high boiling refrigerant means I have a refrigerant for which the normal boiling point is equal to, let us say, minus 10 degrees Celsius. That means corresponding to this temperature, the pressure is 1 atmosphere. Once it is 1 atmosphere, that means if we are going to minus 90 degrees Celsius, the pressure will be very, very low, and hence there will be large suction volume which is at the entry to the compressor. This will lead to increase in the size of the compressor. The third point is extremely high pressure in the condenser if a low boiling refrigerant is selected. Now there can be a possibility, you may say that I will be using a refrigerant for which the normal boiling point is say minus 80 degrees Celsius. Okay, if you are using a minus 80 degrees Celsius normal boiling point, the pressure corresponding to this temperature is 1 bar, and you can say this is the evaporator pressure also, or near to evaporator pressure. And if suppose the condenser temperature is, let us say, 48 degrees Celsius, then the pressure in the condenser will be very high, somewhere around 10 bar. And if we are going for a condenser pressure of the 10 bar and evaporator pressure of 1 bar, then you know the pressure ratio will be very high. And as I have already told you, that we go for a multi-pressure system or a multi-compressor only when the pressure ratio is more than 4 or 5. So this will also not be possible if we are using a extremely high pressure in the condenser with a low normal boiling point refrigerant. The next point says very high pressure ratio. I have told you the above example, and therefore a very low coefficient of performance. You know what happens there is a when there is a high pressure ratio. When there is high pressure ratio, volumetric efficiency goes down. When the volumetric efficiency goes down, mass flow rate of the refrigerant also goes down. Mass flow rate of the refrigerant goes down. Along with it, the specific refrigerating effect, QE, that also goes down. Now you see, if I take the product of the mass flow rate and the specific refrigerating effect, that will give me the value of total cooling capacity. And because both these values of mass flow rate and specific refrigerating effect have gone down, so the capacity will also go down. And simultaneously, I can say that the specific work of the compressor, this will go up. Okay. And because the pressure ratio has also gone up, so there is every possibility that the compressor work will also increase. Now, the next point is, in a single stage system, there will be difficulty in operation of any mechanical equipment at very low temperature. So as the temperature goes down, naturally there will be difficult for the mechanical equipments to work at such low temperatures. So these are the reasons because of which we should go for a cascade system. Okay. Now this point is about the multi-stage compression. We know that multi-stage compression is employed when low evaporator temperatures are required and when the pressure ratio PC by PE is very high. We know already that we will be going for multi-stage compression when the pressure ratio is high. Then the question arises, why we are not using the multi-stage compression? Yes, I will answer that question later on. Now there is a application of R22 refrigerant. It is said here, it is used in a two-stage system up to minus 50 degrees Celsius and in a three-stage system up to minus 65 degrees Celsius. So as I said, that if I have to go for minus 90 degrees Celsius, then probably this system cannot be used because we will be requiring the fourth stage also, and in the fourth stage the pressure in the evaporator will be very very low. I have already told you the applications of the cascade system. The first application is testing of materials at low temperatures, and the second is the blood storage at minus 88 degrees Celsius. So these are the two applications. And when I talk about the testing of the materials at very low temperature, I have already told you that if we have to check the ammunition, guns and all sort of those things which we require in the border areas where the temperature is very low, we need to test the materials or those equipment at low temperatures which are existing at the place of war. Okay, so this these things will be required to be tested in the laboratories before they are put into use at the actual place of war or actual location of the war. Now, if a vapor compression system is to be used for production of low temperatures, the common alternative to stage compression is the cascade system. So, if we don't want to go for a multi-stage compression, then we will go for a cascade system in which what we are doing, in which a series of refrigerants with progressively Lower boiling points are used in series of single stage units. So what is the meaning of this particular point? The meaning of this particular point is, if this is the high temperature circuit, I will use here a refrigerant for which the normal boiling point is high. For example, I can use here ammonia as the refrigerant. In the low temperature circuit, I will be using a refrigerant which has a low value of the normal boiling point. For example, I can go for CO2, okay? But I would like to tell you, the CO2 does not have a normal boiling point. So CO2 does not have normal boiling point. Okay, rather it has sublimation point. So sublimation point means, see, when we talk about normal boiling point, it means we are talking about the atmospheric pressure and corresponding temperature. Okay, so normal boiling point is when at 1 bar a liquid changes into vapor. But if a refrigerant is not changing from liquid to vapor at 1 bar, rather it is changing from solid to vapor. Okay, solid to vapor at 1 bar, then we call it as the sublimation point. Okay, so in case of CO2, the pressure in the evaporator cannot be 1 bar, because in that particular case the CO2 will exist in the solid form. So the pressure here in the evaporator will be somewhere around 5 bar or above it, because at this particular value the CO2 will change from the liquid to the vapor form, and it is existing in liquid form at this particular pressure. Rather, the pressure is a little bit higher than this. Okay, now once again I have shown the cascade system here along with its pH diagram. So it is written here, the cascade system combines two or more vapor compression units as shown in the figure above. The high temperature cascade produces refrigeration at a certain low temperature, TE2. So high temperature cascade is producing refrigeration at temperature TE2. So it is saying that the temperature here is TE2, here the temperature is TC2, whereas in the lower circuit this temperature is TC1 and here this temperature is TE1. So the low temperature cascade produces refrigeration at a still further lower temperature, TE1. So actually in cascade refrigeration system, the cooling is produced at a temperature TE1, which is the low temperature, and this cooling is given by QE1. And at intermediate stage, rather than intermediate stage, in the cascade condenser, if you will see, it is the low temperature circuit condenser which is transferring heat to the evaporator of the high temperature circuit. So this is QC2 for the low temperature circuit, whereas for the high temperature circuit, this QC2 is QE2. So effectively, once again, I would like to tell you that in the cascade condenser, the value of QC, it won't be QC2, it is QC1. So QC1 has to be equal to QE2. So this condition is important. And on the right hand side, I have already told you, this A is approach, this is the temperature difference, okay, between the evaporator and the condenser at the intermediate temperature. So this is A, and its value varies between 5 degrees Celsius to 10 degrees Celsius. Lower the value of the approach, better will be the COP of the system. Using the refrigerating effect of the high temperature cascade at temperature TE2 for rejecting heat in the condenser at temperature TC1, which in limit is equal to TE2. This is the same thing which I have already told you, that we are rejecting heat from the low temperature circuit to the evaporator of the high temperature circuit. In practice, however, there is a certain overlap between these temperatures, that is, the temperature TC1 is about 5 degree higher than TE2. Once again, here it is talking about the approach. So TC1 will be greater than TE2, or I can say TC1 minus TE2 will be approximately varying between 5 degrees Celsius to 10 degrees Celsius, and it is known as approach. It is also to be noted that each cascade works on a separate refrigerant. This I have already told you. Each refrigerant can be chosen in such a way that it operates best within the required comparatively narrow temperature limits. I already told you that if I considered the value of my TE1 as minus 50, and let us say TC1 as say 2 degrees Celsius, and for the high temperature circuit, if the value of TE2 is 0 degrees Celsius and TC2 is equal to 50 degrees Celsius. So you can see in both the circuits, the temperature range is quite narrow. In the first or the low temperature circuit, the value of temperature difference or temperature lift is 52 degrees Celsius, whereas in the high temperature circuit, it is 50 degrees Celsius. So approximately we have distributed equal temperature, but there is a different criteria for the temperature in the cascade condenser that I will talk later on. The high temperature cascade uses a high normal boiling point refrigerant, already told you, such as ammonia or R22. R22 nowadays is not being used. Why not being used? Because its ozone depletion potential is equal to 0.055, though very low value, but it depletes the ozone layer, so we won't be using it now. Whereas the low temperature cascade uses a low boiling refrigerant such as CO2, ethylene, methane, etc., depending upon the requirement. So that means in both the circuits we will be using different refrigerant. But I would like to tell you that a lot of research in this field is going on, and we can the scientists or researchers are trying to see which pair of refrigerants is the best pair. So at the moment you cannot say that ammonia CO2 is a good pair, okay, which is used here in case of cascade refrigeration system. But instead of CO2, we can go for some other refrigerants also. Okay, the use of low boiling and hence a high pressure refrigerant ensures a smaller compressor displacement in the low temperature cascade and a higher COP. So basically, once again, it is said that in the low temperature circuit, we are keeping a low temperature or no low boiling, normal boiling temperature refrigerant, so that we are keeping a appropriate pressure limits within the evaporator and the condenser. Similarly, in the high temperature circuit, we are keeping a high normal boiling point temperature refrigerant. Accordingly, we are maintaining the appropriate pressures and temperatures in the condenser. Now, this slide tells something about the history of the cascade system. It was first used by Pictet in 1877 for the liquefaction of oxygen, employing SO2 and CO2. So these two refrigerants were used initially for the liquefaction of oxygen. as intermediate refrigerants. Another set of the refrigerants commonly used for the liquefaction of gases in three-stage cascade system is ammonia, ethylene, and methane. So basically, the cascade system which are you are seeing here, it is a two-stage cascade. Okay. And usually, if we are using a two-stage cascade, we will be going up to say minus 50 degrees Celsius. If we use three-stage cascade, then we can go up to say minus 90 degrees Celsius. So lower the temperature, the number of stages will increase. Ammonia is also used in the high temperature cascade for the manufacture of solid CO2, and this solid CO2 is nothing but dry ice. So if you have to prepare dry ice, then we will go for a cascade refrigeration system, and in its high temperature stage we will be using the ammonia as the refrigerant. Now this is very important point which is written here. An additional advantage of cascade is that oil from one compressor cannot wander to the other compressors as it generally happens in case of multi-stage systems. So in multi-stage systems, you know how many refrigerants we are using? We are using only a single refrigerant. So when we are using a single refrigerant, in that particular case, the refrigerant while passing through the compressor one may take the oil along with it, and that oil may be transferred to the other compressor. So that is the problem with the multi-stage compression, that the oil from one compressor wanders to the other compressor, means it goes to the other compressor. This thing will not happen if we are using separate circuits of the simple vapor compression cycle, and we are using different refrigerant in that particular case. And you can see in the diagram, there is no direct linking except the heat transfer between the cascade condenser, okay, between the two circuits. The next point is, in the system shown in figure, the high and low temperature systems have to be balanced with each other. Now, what is this balancing means? I have already told you, balancing means that the value of QC1 should be equal to QE2. That means whatever is the low temperature circuit condenser heat, that is to be rejected as the heat in the evaporator of the high temperature circuit. That is the meaning. This means, it's written here also, heat absorbed in the high temperature cascade evaporator must be equal to the heat rejected in the low temperature cascade condenser. Now let us talk about its analysis part, that how to calculate its COP. Okay, so first of all, I would like to tell you that we should know certain parameters for its analysis. What are those parameters? The parameters are, we should know the value of TE1, TE2, TC1, TC2. Then I should know both the refrigerants which are being used in the system. Apart from it, I should also know the intermediate temperature. Intermediate temperature in the sense, yes, once I know the, I won't be needing it actually. Intermediate temperature won't be required because I already know TE1, TE2, TC1, TC2. So automatically I already know the value of the approach. So approach is already known based on these parameters. Yes, I need to know one more thing, and that is actually QE1. So QE1 is the heat which is being supplied here in the evaporator. This is QE1. Okay. So this is also known to us. So we know 7 parameters which are written here: TE1, TE2, TC1, TC2. Two refrigerants and the value of QE1, that is the capacity, refrigerating capacity. So this is known to us. Now you can see, if we know all the temperature, then in that particular case, I know all the enthalpy values starting from H1, H2, H3, H4, H5, H6, H7, and H8. These values either you can calculate using the pH diagram. Though I have not explained any problem based on pH diagram, I will explain one problem in which I will be solving a problem on the cascade refrigeration system. So for the timing, I am considering that we know all the values of enthalpies, and this will be known to us once we are using a pH diagram. If we know all the values from H1 to H8, now I can write the value of the COP. What will be the value of COP? The value of COP will be equal to QE1 divided by WC1 plus WC2. So WC1 is the compressor power here, and WC2 is the compressor power in the high temperature circuit. But now let us try to understand. This value was given to us. Do we know the value of WC1 or WC2? No, we have not calculated these values till now, because we only know the values of enthalpies, and we cannot write this expression in terms of enthalpies only, because the mass flow rate in both the circuits is different. You can see in the low temperature circuit, the mass flow rate is given by the name M dot LTC. LTC stands for low temperature circuit. And in the high temperature circuit, the mass flow rate is given the name M dot HTC. So it is the mass flow rate in the high temperature circuit. So how to calculate the values of WC1 and WC2? So for WC1 to be calculated, what I will do is, I have all the enthalpies. So I can write the equation QE is equal to MR1. Okay, this MR1 is nothing but it is MLTC. Okay, MLTC into, now if you see the evaporator or the evaporator of the low temperature circuit, its exit point is H1 and the entry point enthalpy is H4. So because I have already told you that the values of enthalpies are already known to me, and QE value is also known to me, so from here I can calculate the value of MLTC. So now I will be able to calculate it, because this QE1 is known to me, H1 is known to me, and H4 is known to me. So I can calculate the value of MLTC. Once I calculate the value of MLTC, I can calculate the value of WC1, which is given by M dot LTC into, now what are the entry and the exit points of the low temperature compressor? These are 1 and 2, so we will have to take the enthalpy difference, H2 minus H1. Okay, so WC1 has now been calculated. Now let us see how to calculate the value of WC2 in the high temperature circuit. For this, we will have to use the energy balance across the cascade condenser. So this is the cascade condenser, also known as the evaporator condenser. If you will see, this line is entering at state point 1 and it is leaving at state point 5, whereas this line is entering at state point 2 and leaving at state point 3. So I can apply the energy balance. You know that already we have written, this is QC2, whereas this value is QC1 and this is QE2. So I can say that QC1 is equal to QE2. Now QC1 is the heat rejected in the condenser for the low temperature circuit, and it will be given by m dot L Tc into heat rejected in the condenser is given by H2 minus H3, and this should be equal to heat absorbed in the evaporator of the high temperature circuit, that is m HTC into H5 minus H8. So now you know, we know all the temperatures, but we do not know the value of, we know all the enthalpies, we know this particular mass flow rate MLTC, but we don't know this value of mass flow rate in the high temperature circuit. So it means I can calculate this value by using this equation. This is the energy balance equation in the cascade condenser. Having calculated this value of the mass flow rate in high temperature circuit, I can write that WC2 is given by M HTC multiplied by H6 minus H5. Now you know that the COP is given by QE1 divided by WC1 plus WC2. So we have calculated the value of WC1 also, WC2 also, and QE1 also. So once we have calculated all these three values, we can calculate the value of COP. Now let us talk about the optimum coupling temperature between the cascade circuits. Till now we have focused on the calculation of the COP of the system. Okay, just try to see here. Suppose we are operating at a low temperature, which let us say minus 60 degrees Celsius, and let us say the condenser TC2 temperature is let us say 50 degrees Celsius. So what is the temperature here in the cascade condenser? This temperature is actually known as TCC. TCC stands for temperature in the cascade condenser. So we want to know what is the optimum coupling temperature corresponding to evaporator temperature of minus 60 degrees Celsius and a condenser temperature of 50 degrees Celsius. So for this particular case, what we can do is, as you already know, that the low temperature circuit, the temperature limits are TE1 and TC1, whereas for the high temperature circuit, the temperature limits are TE2 and TC2. So what we can do is, we can equate the COP, which COP? Reversible refrigerator COP for both the circuits. So this is for the low temperature circuit and this is for the high temperature circuit. We will equate this equal to each other. So these are the expressions. This is the COP for low temperature circuit, high temperature circuit, this value and this value. So
excuse me, sir.
Yes.
So you are not allowing any other students in the class currently?
See, problem क्या है कि मैं अब लेक्चर ले रहा हूँ, मुझे पीछे पता नहीं लगता. अब मैं अगर बीच में उनको अलाउ करता रहूंगा, शुरू में 10 मिनट अलाउ करा है, उसके बाद मैंने लेक्चर स्टार्ट कर दिया, उस टाइम पे आ जाते तो ठीक था. ऐसे तो मैं लेक्चर बहुत डिस्टर्ब होता है. ओके
सर, एक्चुअली सर कोड में एरर दिखा रहा है.
अभी तो कितना टाइम हो गया, तो खत्म होने वाला है. अभी रुक जाओ. Okay, so now to solve this equation, okay, though we know all the temperature, we want to calculate what is the value of TCC. TCC. So what is this TCC? It is actually equal to TE2, and we are considering it as TC1 also. So this is the condition that we have considered. So when we take this particular condition, then we can say that this value is TCC, and this is also equal to TE1, and this is also equal to TC1. And when you will solve using this particular condition, then we can say that the value of intermediate temperature will be equal to square root of TC2 and TE1. So TE1 is the evaporator temperature and TC2 is the कंडेंसर टेम्परेचर. तो कुछ नहीं है, एक कंडेंसर का टेम्परेचर लो और एक इवेपोरेटर का टेम्परेचर लो, उनका ज्योमेट्रिक मीन लो, तो उससे जो है हमें टीसीसी की वैल्यू पता लग जाएगी. लेकिन यहाँ पे एक और इम्पोर्टेंट बात आपको बताना चाहूंगा. देखो, हमने ऐसा कभी नहीं हो सकता कि टीई टू और टीसी वन जो है दोनों इक्वल हो जाए. क्यों नहीं हो सकता? क्योंकि अगर दोनों इक्वल हो जाएंगे तो हीट ट्रांसफर नहीं होगा. तो हमने क्या करना है, जब हमने ये टी सी सी कैलकुलेट कर लिया, सपोज इस टी सी सी की वैल्यू आती है 0 डिग्री सेल्सियस, सपोज आई एम टेकिंग एन एग्जाम्पल, और मुझे मालूम है कि मुझे जो अप्रोच का टेम्परेचर है दैट इज एक्चुअली इक्वल टू टी सी वन माइनस टी ई टू. ये मुझे मालूम है कि मैंने इसको 5 डिग्री सेल्सियस रखना है, और कैस्केड कंडेंसर टेम्परेचर जो है उसकी वैल्यू मैंने कैलकुलेट करी है इस इक्वेशन से 0 डिग्री सेल्सियस. तो मैं क्या करूँगा, मैं इसको ऐसे रख सकता हूँ कि टी सी वन की वैल्यू जो है मैं ले लूँ 2.5 डिग्री सेल्सियस, और टी ई टू की वैल्यू ले लूँ -2.5 डिग्री सेल्सियस. तो ऑटोमेटिकली जो हीट ट्रांसफ़र होगा वो टी सी वन से टी ई टू को हो जाएगा, क्योंकि इन दोनों के बीच में 5 डिग्री सेल्सियस का डिफरेंस आ गया. सो दिस इज़ व्हाट आई वांटेड टू डिस्कस टुडे. इफ़ यू हैव एनी क्वेश्चंस यू कैन आस्क.